the world all the time. And he told me how one of his students from Bolivia shared with him that his family would keep llamas outside of their chicken coop to protect the llamas from coyotes. Which seems a little bit ridiculous, because why would a llama offer protection from a coyote? But for whatever reason, it works. For whatever reason, when there is a llama there, the coyote will stay away. Maybe the coyote sees the llama and thinks, wow, that's a really big llama. I'm really small. Or maybe it sees the llama and thinks, that's a really fluffy, soft llama, and I'm just mangy. I'm not sure. The llama might think, who am I to go up against this big, magnificent creature? It's a silly story, but that who am I question is what I want to spend some time with you all talking about this morning. It's a question we'll spend some time considering. Maybe you had a moment of feeling like that coyote who's really quite strong and capable, but who faces a daunting llama that sure looks impressive, even if it really has no idea what's going on. I know a few people like that. To my knowledge, I don't think there are any llamas or coyotes in the Bible, but there are a number of people at a number of places in Scripture who ask, who am I, in response to the challenges that find themselves facing. So we're going to spend some time on this question, who am I? Last week we started our journey together through the book of Exodus, the second book of the Bible, which is really a book about journey, about the people's journeying through the liminal space of the wilderness between the time when they lived in Egypt and the time when they get back to their home. In Egypt, they first lived on equal footing with the Egyptians. But we know, we talked about last week, how over time they ended up becoming enslaved by them. And Exodus is their journey out of slavery. It's a journey that takes them from slavery to freedom, but that freedom first looks like wandering and waiting and searching for 40 years in a wilderness. It's a liminal place. A powerful place in the Christian imagination. It comes from the Old Testament, but it has taken a powerful place in Christian imagination, which makes sense. It makes sense that this is a story that resonated with African slaves in our country, that many of the themes we get in spirituals echo themes in Exodus, echo themes of being liberated from God by slavery, but still not yet making it all the way to the promised land. For me, this story resonates as a Christian living in the liminal space of the church in the 21st century. A church we know doesn't look like what it did 40 years ago or even 20 years ago. When we are all together here on a journey through a wilderness, and we haven't quite gotten to whatever promised land it is that we're hoping for. We don't quite know where we're headed together, but we know we're here together on this journey. The Exodus story has taken a powerful place in the Christian imagination. And it begins with one quirky, stubborn, self-doubting man named Moses. Last week, we together heard the story of his birth, which easily could have ended another way if it wasn't for some very strong and courageous women who made sure that Moses survived. Moses ends up being raised by one of these women, by Pharaoh's daughter, who seems like she's supposed to be part of the enemy camp, but ends up reaching out to him and raising him as her own in the privileged place of the palace in Egypt. But Moses grows up, as children do. One day when he's a young man, he ends up wandering outside of this privileged place of the palace, and he sees that the people he comes from, the Hebrew people, are being oppressed by the Egyptians who have raised him. He sees an Egyptian beating a Hebrew, and he ends up killing that Egyptian in response in his anger. Later he finds out that the Pharaoh knows about it, which is a threat to his own safety, and so he flees to the wilderness It makes sense that he defends them. He defends these women from the people who are harming them. And then, as also often happens in the Bible, he ends up marrying one of them and shepherding her father's flock. So he continues to live outside of his native land, his native Egypt, maybe intending to never have to go back there into all of that oppression and injustice that he knew was happening. He's living a good life. And then we get to today's story, when God calls him back into all of it, into the situation that he wanted to get out of. In our story, Moses is watching his flock when God grabs his attention through a burning bush. God grabs his attention through something that was a normal occurrence, but happening in an abnormal way. Unlike other bushes in the desert that burned and disappeared, it just kept burning. Enough that Moses stops walking and he says, "What's that?" And when that happens, God calls out to him from the bush. And he says, "Hey, Moses, just like you did when you were living there, I too have heard the cries of my people in Egypt. And here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to deliver them. And you're going to help me. So now you go back to them and lead them out. You found a way out yourself. Now I'd like you to also show them a way out. And I'll be right with you the entire time." Imagine being Moses in this moment. You kind of liked how your life was going. A wife, a kid, a decent job, not really too many big problems to worry about. And now you're being asked to do something else. It's something big and great, and you get to be part of it. Perhaps another leader might have jumped right in and said, "Yes, God, I'd love to make Israel great again. I'll do it now." But that's not what Moses does. Moses doesn't take it on upon himself. He doesn't say, "I'll make it great again." God picks someone for the task who has a very different response. Which is what we heard Moses saying earlier. Who am I? Maybe this is what Moses says as an excuse, doesn't want to do it. But it seems like he says it because he really doesn't think that he is the person for the job. Because he thinks he lacks the courage or the skill or maybe the finesse to do the thing that God has told him that he's going to be able to be part of. In the next chapter, Moses continues to press God about this, continues to question God. First he asks, "What if the people don't listen to me? Why would they listen to me? I haven't been there for so many years." And God says, "Oh no, they will. Here's why." And then Moses laments, "But I'm not eloquent. I'm not a good speaker. You should send somebody else, somebody who's better at it than me." But again, God lets him know, "No, you're the one I want to go. And I will lead." When I was in seminary, the dean of the chapel, her name was Jan, she preached a similar sermon each year to the new class of students that came in, and also to the class of students that came, the two classes of students that continued to be there who had already heard much of it before. She did that because she felt like it was such an important and resonant topic that the repetition was needed. The buildup was different each year, but the core was the same. Jan told us about the imposter syndrome, the sense that so many people have that they are the one person in the room who doesn't belong there, that they are the one who doesn't know enough or have enough life experience or enough skills, the one who isn't smart enough or likable enough to be part of the group like everyone else. Imposter syndrome is that subtle sense that in spite of what we may have achieved on the outside, we are still somehow lacking something. We are still not quite right. We are still the imposter who will one day make that out. Imposter syndrome is that subtle voice that whispers, "Who am I?" Jan reminded us each year that so many students, so many teachers day feel that way. Though it's clear from our political season that it's not universal. It's common enough that it was the most, that there was an article about the imposter syndrome that was the most frequently emailed article last fall. Which doesn't make Moses' response to God very surprising. Who am I? They won't listen to me, they won't follow me, they won't take me seriously. However he appears on the outside later, however he acts, however his actions make him seem later, Moses starts off his journey of leadership with self-doubt. And I want to trust that God picks Moses for a reason. That he doesn't pick the self-assured, powerful person, doesn't pick the one who seems to fit the part. That for some other reason, God instead picks bumbling, stuttering Moses. I'm not saying this because I want to praise Moses' resistance or to praise his self-doubt. But I do think that God was working through them, was growing Moses into the person he could be, that Moses had the humility to be grown into the person he could be for the sake of what God wanted to do in the world, which was liberate a whole people. It's a story that strengthens my faith that all of us are works in progress, and that God is continually using all kinds of imperfect, quirky people who God calls together for some reason down the path of following Jesus, that path that each of us in this room is walking or considering walking or hoping to keep walking. Maybe some of you here this morning have the same response of Moses, as Moses, who am I? I know that that has more often than not been my own personal response to God over the years. Who am I to do this? It's a question I still find myself asking. One that in some ways has been a part of my journey with God and my relationship with God for some time. And I trust that you have similar experiences in your own journeys in some way or another. This response of who am I is a response that none of us is alone in, because they were Moses' words so many thousands and thousands of years ago before they could be ours. It was Moses' question before it could be our question. So the hope that I see in Moses' story, the promise of Moses' story, the good news for us and for Moses in it, is that in spite of that self-doubt that we might have, the exodus from Egypt, the people's liberation, the great thing that God is doing is not about who Moses is, it's not about Moses' capacity, but it's about who God is. It's not about how great Moses is, but about how great God is. There's a contemporary song that I love that goes, "How great is our God? How great is our God? Won't you sing with me? How great is our God?" And when I think of this story, those words echo in my head. How great is our God? What defines Moses and what defines us is not what we do or even our personality or the talents that we have. So those things are things that are gifts from God. What defines us is simply that we are loved by God, and that God has formed us and filled us with life that reflects God's own way. And God has formed us and filled us with life and then called us on a journey of being disciples and servants of God with a purpose in the world. God gives us a purpose in the world and promises, "I will be with you every step of the way." God promises us, whatever your doubts, whatever your fears, whatever your unwillingness, "I am here walking this way." We ask, "Who am I?" And God responds by saying, "I am who I am, and I will be who I will be, and I will be with you." We ask, "Who am I?" And God says, "I am who I am, and I will be with you." So thanks be to our great God.